if we can just, I guess, before we begin service, and just take just like 2-3 minutes to go around and say hi to 3 people and just catch up. How's your week? How's your midterms going? And just take 2-3 minutes to have a quick time of fellowship before we begin today. So, I guess before we begin service, if we can all rise if we're able to, and I'd like to open us up in prayer before we begin, so if we can all bow our heads. So God, we thank you for today, and we thank you for gathering all of us here together as one body, and just during this time, God, we pray and ask that may we come before you here today as one body of worship. And that during this time, that any worries, any distractions that we may have, may we just lay them down here before you today and have our hearts directed to you and focused on you only today. So God, we lift this time of worship up to you. We pray all these in Jesus' name. Amen.
What this world Let stay and rest in your holiness, Word of God, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Find myself at a loss for words in the funny. Great is our
We want to welcome you all. You may all be seated. And we want to spend some time in prayer as we continue this worship service. Psalm 118:24 says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in Him." Today is the day that the Lord has made, and we are to rejoice and be glad in Him. And I want to welcome you all to the Sunday worship, and I want to invite you all to come to the Lord today. And so at this time, can we spend some time in prayer for this worship service? Lord, we rejoice in You. And if you're new to Christianity, God gives us true joy in knowing Him. God gives us joy. And if that is your longing today, let's pray and ask the Lord, "Lord, would You come? I want to know You, and I want to have this joy that only You could give." Let's pray for this worship service. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's pray. Father, we want to lift up our hearts unto You, O God. We rejoice. Let the nations be glad and the earth rejoice. Your word says. And God, we want to lift up our hearts to You, O God. Let the nations be glad and let the earth rejoice. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in Him. Lord, I lift up every person that is gathered here. And God, it is Your desire. Your word says You desire all men to be saved and come to know the knowledge of the truth. And today we pray, O God, that You would draw the hearts, O Lord. Draw the hearts to Yourself, O God. God, we pray for every heart and soul precious in Your sight, created in Your image, created to know You, created to live to You, O God. Would You draw the hearts today, O Lord? Father, we thank You for this Sunday, for gathering each heart. And we know that it is Your hand, O God, that You have brought each and every one of us here. And as we worship, we pray You would draw our hearts to You, God. Draw our hearts to You, God, so that we may truly come to know You and worship You and live to You. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. This time we'll have a scripture reading for today.
Today's scripture reading is from John 2, verses 1. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with His disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to Him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does this have to do with Me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever He tells you." Now there were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them up to the brim. And He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it out to the master of feast." So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water now become wine, did not know where it came from. So the servants who had drawn the water knew. The master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then pour the wine, but have kept the good wine until now." This is the first of His signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee and manifested His glory, and His disciples believed in Him.
So the title of today's message is Filled to the Brim.
And our text, as we just read, is a wedding. In the year of 2016, I came across a book titled 12 Ways That Your Phone Is Changing You. And it was a very interesting book. And one of the main ideas of this book was that, and the premise of the book, is an observation of the author that said, and he observed the correlation or the relationship between the use of social media and people's longing for happiness. And 8 years later, I am in full agreement with this correlation. I think we live in a day and age where the use of social media, Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, when you really dig down to it at the core, what it is really about is a pursuit of happiness. Now think with me. What do you see when you go on social media? What is the majority of the things that people post up? What do you post up? Probably good food, a good moment in a vacation, maybe a graduation ceremony. There, people post their relationships, their boyfriends, their girlfriends. People post things that they find funny. When people start a new job, they post it up, take a selfie, maybe in their new job. When they get engaged, their favorite teams winning a sport, hobbies in action. In summary, the majority of the things that we see in social media is happy moments, high points, or what looks like a beautiful life. Probably in the next few months, what we're all going to be bombarded with in our social media is probably political endorsements or political belittling. But I think even that, although the idea of justice is in the air, even that is all about which leader could lead to a better future or bring better happiness to society. However, when you're on social media, there are things you are unlikely to find. You're unlikely to find a photo that shows a family struggling financially or a person showing stress that they have of fear of failing a class or an exam. Nobody posts on social media how they feel lonely. I've yet to see somebody post on social media when they get fired from their job. Nobody takes a selfie, I got fired today, or I failed a class. Nobody posts up when they have a longing in their heart. Nobody posts up, I wish my father would love me. Or after somebody's relationship doesn't work out, nobody shows off that their relationship is broken. They, as a matter of fact, they'll probably delete photos of their ex-girlfriend or boyfriend. But the point is this, social media, or I could say society as a whole, has constructed what happiness is. When in reality, behind social media, behind the facade of social media, are people's imperfections, their sorrow, there's loneliness, or the real picture of life. Now, I'm not saying everything about life is sad, but the truth is the things that people put on social media does not tell the whole story of their lives. Would you agree? But what it does show is that people long for happiness. And the question I want to open up with you today is, do you long for happiness? Do you long for happiness? The answer is probably yes. And if that is you, if that answer is yes, this message is for you. But the Bible doesn't speak about how we can find happiness on the terms of the world. But the Bible offers something even greater. The Bible offers joy. Joy. And that is today's message. Jesus, the Messiah, he is the one who brings true joy. Jesus, the Messiah, is the one who brings true joy to our lives. So we want to look at this story, this narrative, and then we'll just look at how is it that Jesus gives us joy. So the narrative, the setting of the story is in a town called Cana in Galilee. And the characters are brought out from the beginning. There's the mother of Jesus at this wedding. And Jesus was also invited to this wedding with his disciples, meaning that it was probably a close family or a close family friend of Jesus and his family. But a problem arises, and in verse 3 it says, when the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. Now we need a little bit of cultural context. While most contemporary weddings in our day and age, it lasts about a few hours for them in their time, it would often last an entire week, a wedding celebration, 1 week celebration. And it was the responsibility of the groom or the husband to provide the food and the wine for this week-long celebration. And the dynamics of marriage in their time was very family-oriented. It wasn't just about two people coming together to be married. It was about two families coming together. And tied to this wedding was the honor of the family. So I got married a little over 2 years ago. And on our wedding day, I invited all my family, friends, church, and then my wife as well. She invited all her family, friends, and her parents' friends, and it came to about 300 people, and it was during the pandemic. And so we rented a church for our wedding, and so we had the ceremony in the church sanctuary, and then dinner was to be served in the gymnasium of the church. So after the ceremony of our wedding ceremony, after we did the service, our guests were going into the gymnasium to get ready for dinner, and the photographer for our wedding set kind of pulled me and my wife aside and said, oh, the weather's really nice outside. Let's go take some photos. So we went outside, and while the guests are going into the gymnasium, we were taking photos on our own for about maybe 45 minutes. Then we went inside to the gym to where our guests were. And what we found was the food had barely begun to be served. And the food was becoming cold. And to serve 300 people is not easy for a church wedding. And let me tell you something. I was really stressed. I was so stressed that even when I went home that night after I got married, I was thinking about this. That's my confession. The point is, when you have a gathering of all the important people in your life, there is a tremendous pressure to serve your guests well, even in our context. And in this wedding, in our narrative, the wine ran out. The honor of the family was at stake. You guys could feel that and understand it and appreciate it a little bit, hopefully. And so the mother of Jesus, she turns to Jesus at this moment. Now, it's possible at this point in her life that she was a widow, because we don't hear about her husband. And if that is the case, a widow during their time really dependent on her son to make a living, to provide for the family. So if that is the case, it is very possible that she had learned to depend on Jesus as a widow. And as a relative of the wedding, she was turning to Jesus. So that maybe she thought, oh, maybe Jesus will go to the supermarket get some, just do a quick run, grab some wine for the family. And Jesus would respond to his mother in almost a surprising way. He says in verse 4, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? Woman, what does this have to do with me?" Time out. Now, if one of your mothers asked you for a favor and you responded to her and said, "Woman," your mom would probably think you've lost your mind, or you're just trying to be a funny guy that day, or a funny girl, would it not? Yet, Jesus responds to his mother, Mary, "Woman, what does this have to do with me?" Did Jesus lose his mind? Or was Jesus just cracking a joke in this moment? I don't think so. There was another place in the Gospel of John where Jesus would call his mother woman. And that is later on in chapter 19 when Jesus is actually dying and hanging on the cross. He would look to his mom, his mother, and call her woman. In verse 26 of chapter 19, while he's hanging on the cross, it says, "When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, 'Woman, look at your son. Behold your son.'" We know that Jesus, by calling his mother woman from the cross, is not looking down upon her. Because the very next verse, it says, he would ask his disciple to take care of his mother. Jesus was honoring his mother from the cross. Rather, what it appears that Jesus is doing while he is dying on the cross is he is creating this loving distance with her. A little distance between him and his mother. And now that may seem a little bit odd, but this is what we need to understand. Jesus, yes, he was truly a man who was born of Mary. Mary was his mother. Mary gave birth to Jesus. Mary held Jesus as a baby. Mary fed Jesus. Mary helped Jesus learn to walk. And when Jesus spoke his first words, as a mother, as any mother would, she probably rejoiced. She saw Jesus grow up as a teenager into a man. However, as Jesus hung on the cross, Jesus knew that his mother could not, or rather should not, see him in merely human terms, as a normal, loving mother would. Jesus must be more than just a son to her. Jesus wanted his mother to look upon him, to behold him as her savior. For Jesus is not only Mary's son, but Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus was not only an obedient son to Mary, but he was the obedient son of the Heavenly Father. And in John chapter 2, our text for today, Jesus is beginning his ministry. He's beginning to reveal who he is to the world. So it seems that he is, in the same way, creating this lovingly gentle distance from his mother. We know this is true because he says in verse 4, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." The word "hour" shows up a few more times in this gospel. And that hour that Jesus is talking about is referring to the glory that he will share with the Father. Jesus is essentially saying this to his mother: "My life, my time is set to the schedule of the Father. So Jesus, by saying, woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come, shows that Jesus was not disrespecting his mother, but he was showing the first place, the prominence of his obedience to the Heavenly Father for the ministry he was about to begin. So verse 5, Jesus tells these servants, do whatever he tells you. Or Mary trusts that her son will do something. In verse 6, it says, there were 6 stone water jars that were used for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. So if you could imagine maybe the size of, a little smaller than the average trash can that's outside, just for context. And the Jewish tradition held that in these stone jars, the Jewish people were not to eat until their hands had a ceremonial washing. And the servants would pour the water on the guests before each meal. That's what this ceremonial jar was for. And Jesus says, fill those jars, fill these ceremonial jars with water. And so they filled it all the way up to the brim, 6 of them. Then Jesus tells them to draw some and takes them out to the master of the feast. So nowadays, if you go to a wedding venue, if you have a wedding there, there's usually a man that's kind of in the background, and he has like an earpiece, he has a walkie-talkie, and he kind of functions like a master of the feast. And his job is to coordinate the events, and he's in charge of the quality of what is served to the guests at the weddings. If you ever go to a wedding venue, you can look for that guy, the master of the feast. So it's kind of like that. So these servants take some of this jar and bring some to this master of the feast. And the master of the feast, he tastes this water, but it had now turned into wine. And him, not knowing where it had come from, he calls the bridegroom, the husband that's getting married, and says, and he probably thought, he must have got this wine from somewhere. Verse 10, he tells the bridegroom, I know it's your first time getting married, but, you know, usually at weddings, you serve the good wine first. And then when people's tongues, when their taste buds get a little numb, then you give the worst wine, but you save the best wine for last. In verse 11, the end of our narrative, it says, however, that Jesus' disciples knew what had happened. It says in verse 11, this, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The disciples began to believe in the person of Jesus. Why? The master of the feast, it seems like he only saw the sign. He saw the wine, and he didn't even know where it came from. But the disciples saw what this miracle, what this sign was pointing to. It appears the disciples began to see something of the glory of Jesus. And this is what you need to see. This is what we need to see. This is what you need to see. Not just the sign, but the glory. Imagine you're on a family vacation, and let's say you're with your family in a car and you're driving through the deserts of Arizona. And you're going miles and miles, and it's all desert around you. And all of a sudden, you see this huge billboard show up out of nowhere in the desert. It's a big sign. And on the billboard, it's this beautiful photo of the Grand Canyon. And on the bottom of this photo, it says Grand Canyon, 5 miles away. How funny would it be if at that moment you and your family get out of the car and then you just decide to stare at that sign and then you ask your family to get in and you take a selfie with your family in front of the sign and then decide, let's call it a day, and you turn your car around and go back home when the Grand Canyon is just 5 miles away. No, you don't want just the sign. The sign leads to the Grand Canyon. And that's what you need to see here. More than just the miracle, what does this miracle point to? What is the sign pointing to? What is the spiritual reality that this sign is pointing to? And the reality is this, that Jesus is the Messiah, and the Messiah is one who brings true joy. Jesus is the joy giver. Wine running out points towards the spiritual reality of happiness running out in our lives. Happiness runs out in this world. Do you know that? This is what happened in this narrative. In the happiest moment of the bride and groom's life, their wedding celebration, the best day of their lives, they ran out of wine. It would have been an end to the celebration. And you know what? This is how life is. For every smile, for every laughter, every happy moment that's posted on social media, there are 30 sighs that happen in real life, isn't it? Some people think they could find happiness this way. If I get into the graduate school of my dreams, I will finally be happy. But after starting school, wine runs out. Okay, so school wasn't it. They get the job of their dreams. They start making money. This has to be it. This is what's going to bring me happiness. But after a year or two in the workplace, wine runs out. Well, making money, it didn't make me happy. Let me try buying a lot of things. They start buying and buying and buying, but the more they buy, at the end it is the same. The barrel is empty. Wine has run out. Okay. This will bring happiness. I need to get married. Well, after all, isn't that what all the movies and what all the dramas show? This romance will bring happiness. I mean, look at what all the people put up on social media. They look so happy, married. But even in marriage, which, by the way, is an amazing gift from the Lord, still wine runs out. This was the problem of this story. And this is the problem of humanity. This is your problem. This is my problem. Wine runs out. Happiness in this world is fleeting. But the story didn't end there. Jesus turned the water into wine. The potential disaster of this wedding turned into a celebration. And the potential disaster of your life can be changed when Jesus enters into your life. When Jesus enters into your life, he can change your life. The Messiah brings true joy. to his people. I'm going to ask you, do you have this joy? Do you have joy in your life? Do you have joy in your soul? Jesus can give you true joy. Jesus can give you true joy. He said later on in this book, in chapter 15, verse 11, these things I have spoken to you. His words are spoken that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Jesus brings full joy in a life full of dullness. He brings flavor in a heart filled with emptiness. He brings fullness in a world full of disappointment. He gives joy. Some of you may have been going to church for many years, but church has taken the form of an empty shell of yourself or empty religion. There is no joy. It says in our story that the religion of the day, the guests had to come to wash their hands in the large water jars for ceremonial cleansing. Perhaps for some of you, church is just that, or has become just that somewhere along the way. It's just ceremonial cleansing. Church is empty routine or empty religion. The good news, here is the good news. The good news is Jesus can change your empty religion. Jesus can change your empty religion into joy in truly knowing him, into truly knowing Jesus personally. And if that is you, Jesus is inviting you. Jesus is inviting you to know him, to believe in him. Turn away from everything else and turn to Jesus. Now, it is no mistake that Jesus, his first miracle and sign is at a wedding celebration. So in our Bible, in the second chapter of our Bible in Genesis, or the beginning of the Bible, God gives a wedding. You know, God is the giver of marriage, right? And this basically in the beginning of the Bible. And incredibly, when you get to the end of the Bible, Revelation is the last book, chapter 19, there's also a wedding ceremony or a wedding celebration. In other words, the beginning and the end of the Bible, there is a wedding. And it's almost like the Bible is bookended by a wedding, right? And personally, one of my hobbies is reading books. And this is what I've learned over the years, is that when an author, it's a pretty universal rule, when an author decides to give an idea in the beginning and ends the book with an idea, it means that that was an important thing. It was a theme of the book. It was a main idea of the book. My generation, we grew up reading Harry Potter. Anybody read Harry Potter? Okay, some of you. I personally loved reading Harry Potter when I was growing up, and it's 7 books, and it's pretty incredible. This author created a whole world. There's a magic world. There's a muggle world. And every book, each of the 7 books has a plot and a climax, right? But the most impressive thing about this series to me is that J.K. Rowling, with these 7 books, had a theme that was running throughout all 7 of those books. And the theme was this: the chosen one, right, Harry Potter, the chosen one, he defeats the power of evil through the power of sacrificial love. I think that's one of the themes that's running throughout. But Harry Potter, the genre of that series is fantasy. The genre of the Bible, the genre of the Word of God is more than, but not less than, historical. It's historical. And the Bible was written over a period of 1,500 years, and it's split into two sections, the Old Testament and then the New Testament, right? And there were 40 different authors that God used so that we have the Bible we have today, but really it's one author, God the Holy Spirit, who inspired these authors. And you know what? The Bible amazingly has themes that are running throughout it as well. And one of them, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, is the bridegroom. Jesus is the bridegroom of the church. Jesus, the Messiah, is the bridegroom of the church, and there is a great feast that he is preparing. Perhaps the disciples saw this glory. Perhaps they understood that the prophets spoke of this day. Isaiah, maybe 500-600 years before John was written, said this: "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined." Joy, 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 Isaiah spoke about, looking forward to the day of the Messiah. And Revelation, the end of the Bible, this makes it even clearer. 19, verse 7 of Revelation says, "Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready." Last week we heard that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And in Revelation 19, at the end of the Bible, it says, Jesus is also the Lamb who has a bride. The Bible teaches that the end of history is a wedding. And Jesus the Lamb, he is the groom, and his bride, the church. It is a great day where there will be celebration when Jesus, the groom, is united with his bride, the church. This is a wedding that is coming. The wedding in Cana is a sign. This wedding that's coming in heaven, this is the Grand Canyon. This is the glory. This is the Grand Canyon, the wedding of Jesus and his church. This is what this sign is about. And you know what also? This is what your future marriages are about. You know what marriage is? Marriage is a sign as well, right? The Bible teaches. This earthly marriage that you will have eventually is going to point towards Jesus and his church. So when you decide who you want to marry later on in life, the most important quality to look for in your future spouse is this. You ready? The most important thing to look for in your future husband, the most important thing to look for in your future wife, is that they are living for this wedding, Christ and the church. That's the most important thing. Because that's what wedding is about. That's what a marriage is about. It's a sign that points to this, the Grand Canyon. To close, in the first week we started the Gospel of John, we heard that the purpose of John is that these signs are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The wedding in Cana is a sign. You know what that means? It's a sign. It's an invitation. It is an invitation for you to come and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Or more specifically, this sign is an invitation for you to come and join the wedding celebration of heaven, of Christ and his church. Jesus is inviting you to this wedding. Are you going to be there? Are you going to be there? I'm going to get corny for a second. The way you could RSVP for this wedding, the way you could RSVP for this wedding, the way you check off, I will be attending, is by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. Is by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the amazing thing is, if you put your trust in Jesus, he is going to give you joy now for the rest of your life. He is going to sustain your life with this joy. For Jesus, wine does not run out. Even in the most difficult moments of your life that is to come in the future, Jesus is going to continue to sustain you with his joy. Everything this world has to offer, it tastes best in the beginning. And then it gets worse and worse. Isn't that true? But you know what's amazing about the wine that Jesus gives? You know what is amazing about Jesus the bridegroom? What he does for his wedding? His celebration? Jesus saves the best for last. Jesus saves the best for last. If you put your trust in Jesus, he is going to give you joy throughout the rest of your life in knowing him. And then at the end, when you see him face to face, you will see that Jesus will give you the best for last when you're actually face to face with him. So I invite you all to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. I want to pray, Lord, for every soul that is gathered here in this place. It is amazing because your word is inviting us to something so grand. And Lord, I know it is because of your great grace. Lord, I pray for every soul that is here. Lord, would you help us to see and believe and give our lives fully trusted into you, Lord. Lord, I especially want to lift up those who are living in sadness and sorrow, perhaps even in depression and confusion. Lord, would you help them to turn to you, Jesus? Would you give them eyes of faith in their heart? We thank you and we pray your word would bear fruit. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. This time we'll have a time of offering.
So if you'd like to, we have our offering basket in the back, and we have some envelopes next to it. We also have a Venmo if you would like to, I guess, offer something up to the Lord. But during this time, if we could just sing one song before we close with Pastor Tim coming up at the end. If we can just kind of reflect on like today's message, and as we sing "How Great Is Our God." The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great, how great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The God had three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great, how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great, how great is our God. You are name above all names. You are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, how great is our God.
this time, we'll have a time a few announcements.
Welcome. First of all, I'd like to introduce some newcomers. If you can stand up, Ian Kim. I know it's going to be really shy, but I want everyone's Ian Kim and Joshua. You can stand up. Just wait. Joshua and John. And Yeonu Ki. Right. And we have Maria as well. So let's welcome them. And when you have fellowship, let's welcome them. Thank you for coming. And I hope you enjoy the service. And our brochure is at the website, nanochurch.org/EM. Right. Thank you. You can check out the website, but we are seeking for volunteers. Right now, we have one media member and one praise team. Sori will join soon, but we are still looking for someone who can play instrument and praise together at the praise team. And we also need someone in the welcome team, so whenever a new person comes in, we can greet each other. And also, we have Stony Brook Camp Saturday. So we have Saturday morning prayer and Bible study. So we turn here first week at the Stony Brook Temple Isaiah. And the other week, we go to New Heart Mission Church at Hicksville. So coming week, we're going to go to Hicksville. So we will pick you up if you want to join. We will pick you up at 9:20 a.m. at Sex Circle. And next is our Stony Brook campus outreach. So for the believers, us believers, we are gathering at the Stony Brook Jasmine on Thursday's lunch. So lunch is on us. So you can just come and eat and chat. And there will be a time the pastor can answer your questions and maybe pray for you if you have anything. And or you'll just get to know us, get to know each other. So it's a great time of fellowship and during the weekdays. The last announcement is our mission to Africa. Thank Isha for creating this beautiful brochure. So we are going to Uganda on May 20 and coming back on June 1st. So please sign up by March 1st. So we're going to have a mission training on March. And sign up Google form is at the QR code. And also 2023 mission video is at the other QR code as well. So after this service, we have some light dinner. I hope you can enjoy it, and thank you.
Thank you. If we could all rise together, we'll pray together. If you want to start following Jesus, and he is calling you and inviting you, would you at this time just spend some time in prayer? Lord, I want to know you. I want to have this joy that the Messiah brings. Would you just pray that at this time? We'll just spend some time and if we could pray for each other, and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's just pray once for in response to the Word of God. Let's pray. Father, we pray and lift up every heart and soul. And Lord, we know that you are calling us to a life of knowing you. And we're grateful, Lord, that Jesus, you are the Messiah who has come to give true joy, the joy of every nation, the desire and joy of every nation. And your word commands all creation, O Lord, to rejoice in the Lord. And I pray for one person. I pray for each heart and soul to put their trust in you as the Messiah, Jesus, that you'll be their Savior. That they would be able to say, I have found the Messiah, we have found the Messiah, and I am going to live to him. I am going to live to him. Oh God, would you draw, Spirit of God, would you draw their hearts to yourself, oh God, and fill their hearts with the joy that you promised, oh Lord. Jesus, you said that you would give a full joy. And you have spoken these words that my joy may be in you, Lord. And Jesus, I pray, Lord, you would give that joy to them. This joy of knowing you, Jesus, oh God. This joy of knowing you, oh God. Would you do that work upon the souls, oh Lord? Would you do that work upon the hearts, O God? Oh, God, we thank you for your word and your promise. And we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen.